Good afternoon, students. Hope all of you are in high spirits and good of health. And I also hope that you must be preparing for your exams well. Student, today we will discuss the second aspect of the book, The Hindu View of Life, a compilation of Dr. S. Radhakrishnan's lectures delivered by him at Manchester. In the first part, we have discussed the philosophical aspects of Hindu religion. Today, we will discuss its practical aspects, and the assignment is titled Analysis of Chapter 3, that is Hindu Dharma, and it is the part 1. The writer starts his lecture with some of the objections which are raised most often against the Hindu philosophy. First objection which is raised is against its doctrine of Maya. And the second objection is raised that as the Hindus believe in the divinity of the world, then it means that all the ethical rules here are that it does not believe in the ethical rules, and all the ethical rules have become meaningless. Now, Radhakrishnan points out what are the basic objections against the doctrine of Maya. It is contested that as per this philosophy, as per this doctrine, it seems that the natural world around us is unreal. And everything related to this world, which is before us, before our sense perceptions, that is the concept of time, history, relations, and even the very life itself, they are all are meaningless and unreal. And it is a Maya and illusion. And it means that all the efforts of human beings, that all the labor that we are putting in this world, they are useless, because these efforts are directed towards delivering us from the illusion of the world. Now, Dr. Radhakrishnan tries to remove this misconception of the Western world, and he adopts a very rationalistic view here. He makes references to various Hindu scriptures like Vedas and Upanishads. Dr. Radhakrishnan points out that as per Vedas, the world view is very realistic, and the Upanishads believe in the relative reality of the world, and it believes that this world is a creation of Supreme. As far as the thesis of Maya is concerned, it was advocated by great philosopher Shankara. And what does this theory convey? What was Shankara's theory of Maya? According to Shankara, this world of time and space, which is spread before us, is unreal. This is an imperfect world, because this world is is not an organic whole, and this world is perishable. All the experiences here in this world, they are partial, because as Shankara says, what is real and what is true? Whatever is permanent, whatever is changeless, whatever is eternal, that is true. And this world is ever changing. This world is changing all the time. That's why this world is unreal, and it is an incomplete world. So all the experiences here are partial. They cannot be unified in a rounded whole. And the world which is unreal or imperfect, because as it is changing continuously, so Radhakrishnan further says, life has a purpose of transcending of our historical individuality, that is escape from the cycle of birth and death. And this is the attainment of moksha. Now let us see what is the historical process. The historical process is the search for a purpose. It is the search for the reality of the world. It is the attainment of perfection. And this perfection is moksha, which I have called, Radhakrishnan has called, the release from the cycle of birth and death. And with the attainment of moksha, our historical existence ends. But the world doesn't end here, because God has his own free will and he recreates world anew. He recreates another world from the world which gets destructed earlier. Now, this process is explained in a paradoxical statement by Dr. Radhakrishnan. And this statement I got, that world fulfills us itself by self-destruction. So, once the world is destructed, once the world is destroyed, another world takes its place, and this process goes on till eternity. Now, this thesis, it leads us to another conclusion, another stance, that world is a living and creating being. As the world is imperfect, it is active, it is living. Because what does perfection means? Perfection is a condition of absolute stillness. It is stagnation and death. And it is the end of creative activity. So, Radhakrishnan doesn't believe in the concept of eternal heaven or eternal hell, because these perfect states, they doesn't decay, and it means that there is termination of all the activity. And this termination of activity leads to eternal idleness. In the other words, we can say the activity is the characteristic of historical process. Radhakrishnan endorses his view by quoting from philosophers like Spencer, Aristotle, Bradley, and also Einstein. Now, a few people reject Shankara's views as an illusion. But Radhakrishnan says that Shankara was not an illusionist, he was a realist. Because he believed in the extra mental reality of the world. That is the experiences of our waking life. Whatever we see around us, they control our thoughts. And further, moksha doesn't mean the destruction of the world, but the displacement of a false outlook by true one. Thus, he explains this, that avidya, that is lack of knowledge, a false knowledge, is replaced by true knowledge, that is vidya. And this movement from avidya to vidya, it is not the denial of the word, rather it is reinterpretation of word. So this is the realism behind Shankara's views. Further, Radhakrishnan states that there is no dualism between subject and object. Subject and object, they are not two separate entities. They do not have any separate existence. But they are different phases of the same spirit. And their existence depends on the existence of God. God, it means that God has created all. So, Radhakrishnan believes in Hindu philosophy, Hindu religion, Hindu thought believes in monism, not dualism. Now the question arises, how finite rises from infinite? How this world has been created by God? How it has taken birth? This question, he says, that this is mystery, and this, as per Shankara, is Maya. That it is very difficult to resolve this mystery. Rather, it is impossible to resolve the mystery of creation of this world by absolute good. And it is also incomprehensible to draw out any relation between God and world. And Radhakrishnan calls, in the words of Shankara, that it is Maya. It is a great mystery, because human mind has its own limitations. It cannot resolve this rahasya of relationship between God and world. And this incomprehensibility of relation between God and the world, is also reflected in philosophies of Western world also. Shankara says that to understand this world in a better way, Shankara's agnosticism is a better method to understand the world. Next, he says, despite God's incomprehensibility, the human beings and philosophers, they continually try to make him determinate. Because human beings are finite beings and they try to see the reality of world in finite terms. And this world they have seen, his expression, God's expression, and they try to understand the relation of God to world in finite terms. Even Shankara justified this view. And for this, he gives the concept of Leela. He says that this world is the play of God, and this world is the outflow of the surplus energies of God. And it is his means of self-expression. It brings out the rationality, the freedom, and the joyous exercise of spontaneity involved in the art of creation. This principle of self-expression, this is also called Maya. So in this manner, Maya doesn't mean that this world is an illusion, this world is false. Rather, he says this world is imperfect, it is incomplete, and the purpose of this life is to reach from this incompletion, imperfection towards perfection, to attain moksha. And how this world is created, that is Maya, that is a mystery. No scholar, no philosopher can reach that mystery or Maya. It is a Leela of God, of the Supreme. Now we come to the second objection, which is raised against Hinduism. People say that Hindu sees everything in the world as divine. So all the ethical rules as per Hindu thought become meaningless. That is, if a pickpocket picks our pockets, then we cannot say that he has committed any type of sin, because it was divine will. Radhakrishnan strongly answers this objection. He says that all the processes of this world are directed by an all-knowing spirit, and that all-knowing spirit is absolute God or supreme. And God is not remote or external to this world. Rather, he dwells in everything. But this spiritual spark, this spiritual Godhead, which is residing inside ourselves, it dwells in different degrees in every human being, in every creature of this earth. It doesn't mean that the identity of the God with the universe, that they are identical, God and universe are identical. He says, I quote, the word is in the God and not God in the word. There are divine potentialities even in the worst of men, but everything is not God. So here the objection is raised, when God is ruling this world, then the freedom of a human being for acting, it becomes meaningless. But Radhakrishnan says that freedom is the basis of every ethical value. Doctrine of karma doesn't deny it. It is a scientific principle which asserts that the course of nature doesn't run by personal passions or prejudices, but the operation of immutable law. That God is there and he does justice to every human being. There is rule of law, which works not only in outer nature, but in the realm of mind and morals. This world which is revolving, this world which is seen before us, the whole of the universe, it is following some sort of natural law. And this natural law also applies to our mind and our morals. And by doing karma, we make our destiny and we make our character. So, Radhakrishnan says that karma, according to Hindus, is not a mechanical principle but it is a spiritual necessity. It is the embodiment of mind and will of God, who gives justice here and now. After weighing every act and thought of man in his invisible but universal balance. That is, he wants to say, whatever we did in our past life, those karmas, they do not end in our present life. These karma follow us everywhere, even after death, and they are manifested in our new birth. We carry with us the whole of our past, and it is an ineffaceable record, which time cannot blur nor death erase. So he says that past is determinate, but our future is conditioned by our present deeds. We can change our fate a little bit by atonement, by repentance, and this atonement can be done by suffering, by self-conquest, and by repentance we can seek forgiveness of God, though this forgiveness may take some time. Further, one is born as per past deeds, but one can mold his future by his karma in the present. And man is not a mere mechanism of instincts. He can control his actions by the spiritual elements present in him. Every person, every human being, and every creature on this earth has some sort of spiritual spark in himself. Then, by the use of that spiritual activity, by the use of that spiritual presence in us, we can control our action by our knowledge. So here, in doing such type of action, man is free. Radha Krishnan says that everybody is given his cards and everybody is free to play his cards as per his own knowledge. So evolution or regeneration of a human being is possible if he does sincere efforts for it. So karma theory doesn't mean fatalism, as many philosophers all over the world take it to be. The next part of the chapter is defining what is Hindu way of life. He says that Hinduism is not just a philosophy, rather it is a way of life. It has strict code for practice, and in Hinduism, practice precedes theory. Hinduism insists not on religious conformity, but on a spiritual and ethical outlook in life. Says a person, whether he is believer in any faith, anybody can become a Hindu if he follows a specific path, a specific way of life. So Hinduism is not a sect. Rather, whoever leads a life as per the moral laws and seeks for truth is its fellow, is its comrade. And according to Hinduism, dharma is a right action and conformity with the truth of things. But dharma coexists with the desires, and this makes man a whole. Man is not a being which has only spiritual aspects, and man is not a being only with the natural desires, only with the bodily desires. Both the aspects coexist in a human being. That's why he is a whole. So all the activities in man, of a person, they are interdependent, and all his activities are in a unity. Now the question arises that what is the path which is followed by the Hindu people? He says that the Hindu code of practice, it recognizes four ends of life. That is dharma or righteousness, artha or wealth, kama or artistic and cultural life, and moksha or the spiritual freedom. Hinduism considers that this world of desires is linked to the eternal God, But if one concentrates only on worldly desires without having spiritual aspirations, or ignores desires for being temporal, such a life is futile and meaningless. That is, the external is manifested in temporal, which in turn is pathway to the former. Means that the eternal world and the temporal world, they are interconnected to each other, and the eternal is reflected in the worldly existence, and the worldly existence is a path, is a passage towards the eternity, towards the realization of the goal of life. And this can be attained by following the path of dharma, the truthful action, the righteousness in our lives, by adopting the righteousness in our lives. Next part of the Hindu code of practice is the craving for money, that is artha, the craving for power and property. He says that this is a natural desires in human beings, that is the pursuit of wealth. It is a natural aspiration, but it should be guided by dharma or righteousness. We shouldn't follow immoral means to collect money, and we should make use of this money in the well-being of society if we want to attain spiritual freedom or moksha. So to obtain this spiritual freedom, one has to lead a life of discipline. We have to surrender all our personal inclinations, all our personal desires, and we have to lead a disciplined life as per the rules laid down by our religion, as per the code of ethics. Third aspect is karma. He says that all the ends of life, they require discipline, whether it is dharma or artha or moksha. We have to lead a disciplined life. We have to follow ethical disciplines. And now the question arises, how to attain the freedom? And for once again, Radha Krishnan explains this method to attain freedom in paradoxical terms. He says, freedom can be obtained through bonds of discipline and surrender of personal inclinations. That is, we have to tie ourselves to discipline. We have to lead a disciplined life, and we have to give up all our personal ambitions, all our personal inclinations. And in that manner, we can attain freedom. We can attain moksha, this world. Because to enjoy and to acquire wealth, we have to limit and bind our will in certain ways. That is, we should have self-control in having the worldly pleasures. Now, the next aspect is moksha. Moksha is the spiritual realization or self-emancipation. It is the fulfillment of our spirit in us. And this is the ultimate aim of human life. All the activities of human life, to earn money, to enjoy the pleasures of body, and all our deeds, all our karmas, they are directed to the realization of this end, which is the perfection in this world, and which is the release from the cycle of birth and death. Now the question arises, how to obtain this freedom? How to obtain this freedom from the cycle of birth and death? And what are the pathways to realization or moksha? Hindu thinkers give three pathways, that of jnana, bhakti, and karma. Jnana doesn't mean intellectual exercise. It is wisdom, and it is the realized experience. It is the true insight into the worldly reality. Next is bhakti or devotion. Bhakti coincides with jnana when it reaches its heights. And third path to moksha is karma or service or leading a virtuous life, in a life in which both jnana and bhakti are reflected. Now karma has two aspects. One is individual aspect and other is social aspect. This chapter deals with the individual aspect, which is represented by the theory of ashrama. Ashrama or the stages of life. As per Hindu thought, there are four stages of life. He says that life is a pilgrimage to the eternal life and it passes through various stages. And these stages are brahmacharya, grihastha, vanprastha and sannyas. Brahmacharya is the first period of our life, that the first period, which is the period of training and discipline of body and mind. In brahmacharya, it is said that a disciple should stay at the house of his teacher and he should learn the world, the ways of the world, because he has to move and to prepare himself for the second stage of his life, that is grihastha. Grihastha is the life of the householder. That is the life, it is the life of action. Third is vanaprastha, which is the period of retreat from all type of social activities. And sannyas means the renunciation of this world and awaiting of for freedom. Now, second stage we were discussing, that is grihastha. In grihastha life, Hindu dharma encourages married life and it discourages monastic life. And in Hindu religion, Hindu thought, marriage is considered as sacred. It is a means of spiritual growth in which all the individual, all the personal instincts have to give way to a greater goal. And it is the development of personality and continuation of family ideal. Here he says that the physical pleasures, they are the basis of intellectual and moral intimacies within the institution of marriage. In the institution of marriage, the sensual love is sublimated into the self-forgetful devotion. Here, Radha Krishnan says that in Hindu religion, Hindu thought, both men and women are servants to a common higher ideal, which they should pursue, subordinating their personal inclinations and sensual love. In Hindu thought, monogamy was accepted and it was called a perfectly ethical marriage. And further, marriage was considered to be an indissoluble relation, and this relation is to be created by the efforts of both men and women. They have to put hard work into it and they have to give up all their selfishness and selfish desire. They cannot be self-centered here. Further, Radha Krishna says that marriage is not the end of struggle, but the beginning of it. Because here one attempts to realize a larger ideal by subordinating private interest. And it is done by restraint and endurance. And by this method, love can be raised to the level of divine. In Hindu thought, women were also given equal status. They are called Sahadharmini or the helpmate. And even women were considered superior to men in that they were capable of self-control and self-denial. Different responsibilities are given to men and women in Hindu religion, because he says that woman has the responsibility of giving birth and rearing the child. That's why she is exempted from all type of economic activity, while man is expected to take worldly pursuits. Third stage of life, the third ashrama in which we enter after grihastha stage, is vanprastha. Vanprastha means giving up of all the responsibility of family and home, and both husband and wife are required to go to the solitude of forest and they have to meditate there for spiritual aims, and they have to meditate on higher pursuits. After vanprastha comes the life of a sannyasi. Sannyasi means giving up wife, children, work, caste and all other worldly pursuit and walking alone in the forest. It is the attainment of a state of spiritual freedom. And in So in this stage, a person develops the spirit of equanimity. He takes everything, whether he success or failure, or pain or pleasure, with equanimity. Or the solitary souls without, they are the solitary souls without personal attachments or longings. And sannyasi means surrendering of I and mine. That is, they have to give up their egos. Hinduism believes in gradual, stage by stage growth to renunciation, and it doesn't condemn life of a householder, as liberated soul also is not indifferent to the welfare of the world. The people who get liberated, who have got emancipation, who have renounced the world, actually they do not become indifferent to the welfare of the world. They spend their life in for the well-being of humankind. As here he gives the example of Lord Buddha. When Buddha was on the verge of nirvana, he didn't accept that. He didn't enter into nirvana, but he left it midway and took a vow that he will not accept nirvana as long as even there is a single human being left on this earth who is suffering and who is in any type of sorrow. He gives example of Shiva also, who drank poison for the sake of the world. So sannyasi is the freedom on higher level of existence, and expresses itself on the lower level. And a sannyasi should have courage to suffer, sacrifice and die. Further, Radha Krishna says, in our present times also, this fourfold path of Hinduism, of life, fourfold path of life, it still dominates Hindu minds. And this is reflected in the lives of natural elites. As he says, that the general character of a society is to be judged not by the masses, but by its great people, the natural elite. And they are the best representative of any culture, any society. So this is the Hindu Dharma, its practical aspect. And here he has narrated the four ashrama and different pathways to attain moksha. Perhaps you must have understood what was basically the Hindu philosophy, what Hindu thought stands for. Thanks a lot.